So one of the headlines for December 2019 is that within a decade, half of the country will be obese. One in four will be morbidly obese, as in BMI over 35. Do you believe that? Well, it was in the New England Journal of Medicine. We'll talk about it in just a minute, but first let's go back and talk about some of our previous discussions about diet. In my mind, I've always said the biggest dietary mistakes really aren't what macronutrient. Am I low carb, low fat, high fat, plant-based versus animal-based? In fact, I talked about some really weird diets. Penn Jillette losing 100 pounds on a potato mono diet. Yes, I got grief for it. But my bottom line was, when we focus on all of these different simple or maybe complicated techniques for dieting, maybe we're fiddling while Rome burns. How did I come up with them? I told you, it's my experience as a doc, treating thousands of patients and teaching thousands of docs how to do prevention. Now, mistake number one is not knowing that you have insulin resistance, prediabetes, metabolic syndrome, type 2 diabetes, and therefore that you can't metabolize carbs. Well, I went into some detail on that. But mistake number two was too much focus on diet, carb, keto, paleo, 5-2, clean diet, etc., etc., and not enough focus on BMI or fat mass. A viewer asked me recently, why are you so focused on weight and not fat mass? I'm focused on fat mass. We used to think fat was an inert storage tissue. It's not. Fat releases enzymes. It's a hormonal tissue. So, to the New England Journal article, it was in December of 2019, Obesity Trends, Ward and Associates. Again, here's the headline. Half of U.S. adults to be obese by 2030, with over one in four in severely obese. Here's the actual article itself. December 19th, 2019, projected U.S. state level prevalence of adult obesity and severe obesity. Special article? Yeah, it's a special article. This one thing is driving more health problems in our country than anything, perhaps the exception of aging. So is the New England Journal. It's got to be right, right? Well, I think their techniques were 100% spot on, as they usually are. However, I don't entirely believe this, and I'll tell you why on the last, at the end. So here's the estimated prevalence. This is a BMI of 30 or greater on the left-hand side. And as you see, well, red is when they get up to 30%, and blue is up over 50%. Nationwide, over 50%. The green over here, see, you know, green is supposed to sound good, but green actually, in this series of images, is a BMI of 30 or greater, or 35, less than 35. So I don't think that really deserves a green in terms of image, but again, that's a bunch of silliness and opinions. Here's the problem. You get up to yellow and orange, and over one in four at that point has a BMI of greater than 35. Morbidly obese. Here's another way of looking at it. Again, overall, this is a BMI. In this beige area, the BMI is 25 or less. In the orange, it's overweight, 25 to 30. So again, over half of our folks are going to have a BMI of up to 30. This is 50% prevalence here, and it just cuts straight on up through. You see here, breakdown by male, female, gender, race or ethnic group, household income. And again, a bunch of bad news. You can look it up and say, okay, what state do you live in? I live in Lexington, Kentucky. So prevalence among women is 55%, among men 55%, BMI equal to or greater than 30. For BMI equal to or greater than 35, it's 23% in men and 33% in women. A third of women in Kentucky morbidly obese. Now, I said I don't really believe that. Why would I not believe that? And wait a minute, how did they do this anyway? How did they develop these numbers? They looked at the Behavioral Risk Factor Survey. It's a national survey on what people do in terms of their risk factors and behaviors. And NHANES, National Health and Nutrition Survey, they looked at that since 1990, and the behavioral risk factor since 1993. They used statistical methods to adjust and correct bias. So again, what do I think? I'm an optimist. I think we're going to bend the curve. How do I think we're going to do that? That's for another video. Thank you for your interest. If you missed the Louisville event, that's bad news. It's especially bad news because it was a great event. We had 50% more people than I've seen at these type of events. And here's the big thing. We had three senior patients, folks that have worked with us for a year or two, Chuck, Gene, and Mark Bentley. Now, these individuals got up and shared their experiences as a patient and demonstrated that, yes, they'd had challenges and here's how they worked through them successfully. As they began to present, things changed in terms of the tenor in the room. Folks became very emotionally engaged and began to realize that you don't have to be a doctor to understand all this stuff. You don't have to be a doctor to be a successful patient and prevent your own heart attack, stroke. So here's the good news though. If you missed that one, we've got another one. We've got one coming up February 28th in Orlando. So take a look and come see us. Look forward to it.